The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret society, the secret oath, and the secret proceedings.
Waking humanity, one soul at a time. This is the World You Don't Know Radio Show with your host, Nick O'Connell.
Now, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're very welcome along to this week's show, The World You Don't Know. Myself, Mick O'Connell, and I have a guest in the studio with me. I've got one of my old friends, Darren, Darren Whelan. Good evening, Darren.
Evening, folks.
And he sat in with me before, so we're just going to be chit-chatting away. I don't have a guest lined up on Skype or via the phone, but I do have some good guests coming up now in the next few weeks, and we're going to be talking about one or two subjects tonight in relation to a guest I have on next week. I've got a guy coming on next week called Richard Terrill. He's a NASA scientist, and he's agreed to come on the show. A bit of a big catch for me, even for a small little show like this, but I'm delighted to be getting him on. And we're going to be talking about a very interesting subject, and it's something that is absolutely far out there. Most people will laugh their head off at the first mention of it. And the subject is, are we living in the Matrix? Literally.
Well, I kind of laughed when you said it to me today, you know.
Well, I mean, according to the latest scientific research, and like some top players have been coming out with this, like Neil deGrasse Tyson, Elon Musk, the owner of Tesla, even he's come out now, and they're apparently now paying large sums of money to physicists to try and find this out, and if it is true, how do we get out of it?
Yeah, I've seen the video with Elon Musk, actually, and he was trying to explain it, saying it was a possibility that they were relating it to gaming and how that's advanced in the last 40 years.
Mm.
And he just said, like, in another 50 years, we could be all just plugged in, like, and to your virtual reality, more or less.
But what Elon Musk, I mean, that was the first place I heard it was Elon Musk, because I was interested in looking at his latest innovations in relation to free energy and, you know, electric cars and all that sort of stuff. And he's sort of like the forerunner to everybody. Like, he's out there, he's like the new Nikola Tesla.
Oh, he's brilliant,
you know, like, he's an amazing bloke, and he's a very young bloke. He's only in his very early 40s, and like, he's already a billionaire like 5-6 times over. And like, for anyone who doesn't know who Elon Musk is, he started PayPal. That's basically where he made his money.
Yeah,
started PayPal, sold that off to Google or whoever bought it, and
kept
the rest
on
is
going.
History. And he has Tesla Motors now. Wants to free the world from oil and fossil fuels. That's his mission. But he was saying at this conference, he was asked a question. Do we live in the Matrix? Some guy in the audience asked him just the question, and the answer he gave was that all the mathematics that they use at the moment to describe the nature and the structure of the universe only works properly if you apply it to a simulation. It doesn't work if you apply it to the material physical world. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
And it only makes sense when you apply it to the Matrix, like to a virtual hologram or a simulation.
Yeah.
No, digital universe.
Yeah, like, I know, I have a funny little idea about it myself. Yeah, like, I know what you're saying.
Well, what's your funny little idea?
Well, that your consciousness is that part of the digital world, you know what I mean? I know, like, your consciousness is uploaded to the Matrix, is what you say, and they are just now downloaded into a physical body.
So you think...
Well, I don't think. No, this is just...
No, well, I'm trying to make sense of what you're saying. Like,
yeah, I know, it's hard, yeah.
This is like a major, like... I don't want to use the word in mind, whatever, but it's...
Well, it's a theory, like, you know. Like, if you can imagine it, it's possible. That's what I think.
But what intrigues me most about it is, and this is only something I've gotten into recently, because other things that popped up that we were talking about earlier on, like the Mandela effect and stuff like that. Like, the Mandela effect to... Someone that has absolutely no interest in simulation theory or would say simulation theory is just, it's just that, it's a theory. There's no basis in fact or anything like that. We live in a physical universe that is in and of itself outside of consciousness, and we just happen to be, you know, these physical beings that live on this planet, and our consciousness derives from our brain. It's not outside of our brains. That's the pure...
Well, that's reality.
That's the pure materialistic way of looking at it.
Yeah, right? Of course.
Of looking at the universe, that the universe is just purely physical. There's no consciousness whatsoever in the universe. It's an individual thing amongst ourselves, that our brain gives rise to our consciousness, that it's not something outside of us,
yeah,
right?
It's a 3D world, or 3D universe.
Now, that's how a material person...
Or 4D.
That's how material... you know, someone who's into materialism, that's how they would see the world and reality as itself. Someone who was into what Plato was into, like idealism, they would say what you just said, that the whole universe is one consciousness. And when we get into this physical reality, it's like what I was saying to you earlier on about the lake. in Star Trek. Remember the character in Star Trek?
Yeah.
And Odo. Mm. And he was a being. He was like a blob, but he could change into anything he wanted. And when he went back to his home world, he became part of the lake, which was the greater being, so to speak.
Yeah,
And he was one aspect of this one being.
That's it. I remember saying that as a kid.
But that's it. I seen it, but I wasn't a kid when I seen it. It was in my very early 20s, I suppose. I was a kid, But what you said earlier on about consciousness, like when you die, you go back to the greater consciousness, but for now you're sort of separate from it.
Because you're at the moment you're self-aware. You know what I mean? You're conscious, you're self-conscious of yourself. You know what I mean? But when you pass on, like, your consciousness is your energy that goes back to the greater energy. And you're no longer conscious of yourself, you're conscious of everything.
So do you think that when we do die, like Bill Hicks said it, there's no such thing as death. Life is just a dream and the imagination of ourselves. And it sort of ties in with what you were just saying there, that, you know, we're conscious beings having spiritual beings having a physical experience. And when you die, that energy, that consciousness, that describes you, that energy, goes back into the greater consciousness.
Of course, yeah. Well, that's what I think, anyway.
So when you were born, do you think you're born with a conscious, like with a conscious mind, or do you think that consciousness like enters your body at some point after your birth, or do you think it happens at the moment of conception?
Well, I don't know, see.
Like, is a sperm conscious?
Well, is it?
Is an egg conscious?
I don't know. I think it's possibly something that, it's energy that evolves. Like, when you're a child, you're not self-aware. You're just, as you get older, you come to different levels of consciousness.
Yeah, I've been observing my own son over the last couple of weeks, especially.
Yeah.
Right, Charlie, and I am not joking, Mitch, I have noticed over the last couple of weeks that he's becoming self-aware.
Yeah.
And I've noticed it from some of the things he's been saying and some of the things he's been doing.
Mm.
Right, and I think it started to happen. His birthday was on the 26th of November gone.
Mm.
And myself, my partner, Karen, we got Marshall, Paw Patrol, one of the characters from Paw Patrol, to come to the house. You paid him for an hour and you came out all dressed in the whole suit and all that, right? And Marshall came out and all the kids were there and they all believed, because I got to walk the door to Marshall and he's there, his face lit up. Oh, hello, Marshall, and come in, Marshall. And Marshall was there for the hour. But here's what happened. After the party, the girl was going back to the car. Before she came in, she were over in Eddie's house and she got changed in there, came out and knocked on the door. But when she was getting back into the car, she took her head off. And Charlie seen it.
Yeah.
And he looked and said, that's not Marshall, that's a lady. And I went, like, I wasn't happy about it, you know what I mean? I said, she should have had a bit more common sense. But it was a simple mistake to make, but nevertheless, it spoiled it for him. And I think at that moment, something clicked in his brain.
Well, yeah, like,
you know what I mean? Hang on a minute, what's going on here?
That's the first big disappointment he's like, you know what I mean?
It was a big disappointment.
It was, yeah. It's like, whoa. No, well, like, I can pinpoint the moment, but I have a memory of it, when I became self-aware. I was trying to go to sleep and I was shouting to my mother at the time, I can't sleep. She goes, why? I said, I have voices in my head. And that was just like, obviously, you know what I mean? I was thinking, obviously, you know what I mean? But it was just, you know what I mean?
You didn't know, you'd just become aware that there was a voice in your head.
Yeah, you had like a thought, you know what I mean? Like, to me, it was as strange as
I'm wondering, right, just for this is just a theory now, this is just me thinking here. And I want to get it out before the thought disappears to the back of my brain and then you hear from again. I say, just imagine this if you will, like my Charlie been 4 years, like without a conscious awareness or whatever.
Well, right? No, it's not conscious. He always had a conscious.
But I'm wondering,
just
is
aware.
The universe like watching him and all kids for that matter, right?
No, I don't
and
think it's. No,
at that moment when he seen that girl taking the head off and it twigged with him, was it a consciousness enter him then?
And that's just his consciousness.
Do you think it just switched on?
No, it switched another level on there, like another.
Oh, went up a level.
Yeah, like. Your conscious is...
Like, I know he's looked in a mirror before that and knew it was him. You know, like, looking at his own hair and stuff like that.
No, it's a collection of... moments in your... You know what I mean? Like, a collection of memories. Like,
But if you liken this to a game, like... I mean, you're a gamer, Darren. I know you haven't played games in a while.
Yeah.
But you were another gamer back in the day.
Yeah.
You know, PlayStation playing Grand Theft Auto
of course,
or whatever.
Yeah.
And you know, like, from playing them games, the moment you put that game in... It's like the Big Bang when you switch it on for the first time. You know, you've got your universes laid out in front of you, but nothing's happened in it. There's no characters have been killed. Nothing has gone on in that game whatsoever. And, like, if you will, the consciousness of the game grows as you get better and better at that game.
Yeah, I think they're actually quite dangerous because you do get sucked into them. And I've often, like, as you... been up till 4 or 5 in the morning playing a bloody game. You know?
I remember, like, when I was in my early 20s, I got a PlayStation 1. And one of the biggest games I got at the time was Tomb Raider, the original Tomb Raider. a brilliant game like Lara Croft. Ooh. And this is like 20 years ago, 25 years ago nearly, when the PS came out, I think. The mid-90s anyway was when it came out.
Yeah, it was actually.
And I got one, and I can't remember what I paid, but it was 300 quid or something at the time. Like, it was expensive enough for a PlayStation 1, you know, graphics-wise compared to the PS4.
But they were leaps and bounds ahead of
absolutely,
Nintendo.
Yeah, of what came before it. But I can remember playing that, and you just saying that it's dangerous. I remember going to work, and I'd be in work, and I'd be walking away like spray painting something or sanding something down and getting caught up in the moment of the game be going on in my head. And I'd be thinking about strategies and stuff like that I was going to do when I go, like it was real. You know, like you were saying, like you can tell.
No, it doesn't mean, like it sucks you in and it kind of it consumes you, like, you know, like it actually does. And you prefer your gaming life to your real life, you know what I mean? That's crazy, like, but
it does happen.
For a short period of time, you spend like you zone into that game for like 4 or 5 hours, like, you know what I mean? And that's your focus, like, you know what I mean? You just become quicker at pressing the buttons, you know, and that's the better you get at it. You do things without actually thinking about it. You just react with your fingers, you know.
But now getting back to consciousness, because that's what we were talking about. Like, as I said with my Charlie, up to that point, when he's seen that character Marshall, for all intents and purposes, that character was real. That character crawled down out of the television and came to the house.
It's actually quite sad, isn't it?
It was very sad. It was like, you know, finding out about Santa for the first time, I suppose, you know what I mean? Like, and that, luckily for us, that's still there with him, like, you know what I mean? But he wasn't stupid. Like, as soon as he's seen that head coming off, like, it was just his reaction, like, it was just, oh my God, like, that's not Marshall. And like, he knew, like, that's a lady. And he hasn't said it since, do you know what I mean? But
he won't dwell on it, but yeah.
You know, it's sad, I suppose. But like I said, I have been noticing them over the last... And like, I've other children, and it wasn't something I noticed for any of them. I wasn't looking out for it, I suppose. But since that is something that I'm aware of, it's something that you sort of look out for from time to time when you're watching what they're doing and stuff like that. Like, he goes around the house during the day singing songs to himself and
trying to keep
stuff
that
like that. But I've noticed him becoming self-aware. Definitely becoming self-aware. Like, he's definitely becoming aware of who he is, and his little place in the world and stuff like that, and how important he is. And
like, everybody goes through it. Every single one of us have to go through it.
Well, he's going through this phase now at the moment where he has to be forced. Like, you know, he gets out of the car. Oh, you have to get out of the car first. Anyone else gets out of the car first before me, there's going to be killings. And, you know, if you don't let him out, like,
jeez,
he's going to annoy you for the next hour then crying. He did it today. Karen got out of the car first. He was upstairs for an hour crying, you know, because he didn't get out of the car first.
Kids, you know, are nuts.
Oh, this fella is nuts. Anyway, moving on. I'm going to be going through the ads in a couple of minutes. The Russians did it.
The Russians always did it, didn't they?
I mean, what?
It's always been the Russians. Come on.
Well, here's my point about the Russians did it. There's going to be people sitting at home watching the news thinking, oh my God, those pesky communist Russians, what are they up to now? Blaming them for... The CIA have come out and blamed the Russians on hacking the American information system, if you will.
Okay.
Grabbing emails and releasing of the WikiLeaks, or WikiLeaks could release them and embarrass Hillary Clinton, and that's why she didn't win the election, and the fake news and the...
Are they original documents?
Well, I don't know what was sent to WikiLeaks, if anything was sent to WikiLeaks, but for them to come out and say it was the Russians, you can see what they're trying to start here. They're demonising the Russians.
No, but that's just the usual thing. Like, they're making the act out to be bigger than the information. What's important is the information. Is it real? Is it credible? And doesn't matter how it got out.
But do you think that... Look, I've been watching the media now over the last few days, especially the American and the British media, and the headline news is the Russians helped Donald Trump get the election. Now, I have a theory that Donald Trump won't make it to the White House. And I have a theory that Obama is going to announce a third term, which is unprecedented in American history, but it can happen. I think that the laws are... The statutes are on the books. Like, these executive orders that... previous presidents have lying down. They've given themselves the legal ability to pull this off and do it. It's a coup d'etat, basically, but using legal means and using outside external threats that don't actually exist. You know, I mean, they're coming out with all this stuff about fake news. I mean, if you want fake news, go back to 2003, 2001. You know, we had 9/11. Next thing all over the news, Bin Laden did it. Right, everybody believed that, fair enough. I don't believe for a second that he did. And then what else came out with that news was, oh, Saddam Hussein, he has weapons of mass destruction. He wants to kill us all.
Yeah, but like...
A million Iraqis died based on fake news because there were no weapons of mass destruction.
More than a million.
So for the mainstream media to be running stories about fake news, it's like the kettle calling the pot black. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, but that's there has been a backlash against the mainstream media, and I don't think people are taking it seriously.
But this is what I'm saying. This is why they're coming out with these stories about alternative news websites like Infowars and DavidIke.com. Like People's Internet Radio, this show, for example,
it's counter-propaganda is what it is. It's murky the waters a bit, you know. They mix it all up and just dilute it. Like they've been doing it for years in different aspects. Like, you know what I mean? We all know that. And now they're just, like, it's...
But I see this as like an unprecedented attack on alternative media, because if you look at alternative media over the last, say, 10 years... It's been doing its own thing, reporting what it perceives to be.
Yeah, but that's they weren't worried about it then.
But they seem to be very worried about it now.
That's because it's had a massive effect. It wasn't a threat back then, so they didn't really care about it, and they let it go. But it blew up in their face, because a lot more people started making more sense of things, and they obviously, you know, now they are worried about it, so this is what they have to come out with. Like, that's what I think, like...
Do you think Donald Trump is going to make it to the White House? Or
they use the flat earth theory now, in my opinion, my personal opinion. You know what I mean? Make people sound crazy. And there's loads of stuff out there. So it's just another way to live.
I've interviewed someone about the flat earth on this show. Yeah. I had Mark Sargent on here about a year ago or something like that. And as I said to him on my show, and I've said this many times on the show as well, like the flat earth stuff, look at it if you want. I mean, it's entertaining to look at. It's information. And it is very entertaining to look at. Like the big what if about it. But as I said before, I couldn't give a toss two ways or the other, whether the earth is flat or whether it's a ball.
It's
a hellhole to live on. There's a lot of shit going on, and there's nothing most of us can do about it. And none of us are getting off this planet anytime soon.
Exactly.
So why even bother looking at that sort of stuff?
No, but it's stuff that's put out there. So this is just another way. It's just a new angle. Like, you know what I mean? You can't... they have to maintain,
but I don't think the flat earth
thing control worked. You have to be able to maneuver, like, you know.
But I don't think the flat earth stories worked on... You know,
they couldn't possibly work.
But if the flat earth thing was thrown onto the internet, and it did, it was on the internet for many years, and it was talked about like on the very, very outer fringes of alternative information and news and media and stuff like that. But it sort of found its way onto the mainstream alternative, if you want to call it that.
Yeah, well,
about a year and a half ago, but it exploded.
Obama said it, didn't he?
We don't have time for the flat earth society or something.
Yeah,
he's
right though. You know, like, unfortunately, it is. I think it was loony. So I spoke to a lot of people, and they actually do believe it. No matter what you say to them, they believe it.
That the earth is flat.
Yeah.
But like I said, doesn't matter what shape it is.
No, I know it doesn't matter, but it's just. It's a divisionary tactic, I think.
But listen, I've got to go to some ads, folks. I'll be back in 2 minutes with myself and Darren. Talk to you very soon.
Broadcasting to Lucan, this is Lippy Sound, 96.4 FM.
Now, folks, you're very welcome back. Hold on, just messing with the level there. Now, what were we talking about? Yeah, we were talking about Donald Trump and whether he will make it to the White House. Now, as I said earlier on, I have a theory that with all this stuff that's going on in the mainstream media, like the Russians did it, yesterday then you had the Chinese are giving out now because Donald Trump didn't ring them, he phoned the Taiwanese instead, you know. Probably because they make better products, that's why he phoned them, you know what I mean?
Well, he probably has a job for them, you know.
But I can't help thinking, because as I was saying to Jordan the break, the Americans have the ability written into the legislation, which was done by successive presidents before Obama and Clinton and etc. down through the years, like they were sort of setting the stage for what they can do now if they wanted. And they've got the ability, if it turns out that they run a probe, say, between now and January the 20th, over the next couple of weeks, like 4 weeks in politics is an extremely long time. Anything can happen.
True.
You know, now, if they've got the ability to halt the inauguration based on criminal accusations, you know, they could say Donald Trump colluded with the Russian communists to, you know, manipulate the American election.
I don't know, just like... Where would the evidence be for it? You know, like, he contacted them directly.
But where was the evidence that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction?
Exactly,
and a million people died because of it.
Yeah, but that's the Jewish-owned press, really, isn't it, over in America?
But the press worldwide, the international media is owned by five big corporations, all owned and controlled by Zionists.
Exactly. So there you go, that's where it was. There was never any weapons. It was just, we're going to war with these people, and this is how we're going to make you believe it. Like, there was... Do you remember, like, there was marches, there was millions of people marched, millions of people across the world.
Yeah, and they were ignored.
They were ignored. We even marched here.
Yeah, there was a sizable march in Dublin too.
No, this is wrong. We knew it was wrong. And even, that was before the Grand Awakening, as you would say. Not the Grand Awakening, but before a lot of people.
But there was a Grand Awakening after 9/11, without a doubt. I think there was.
Yeah, slowly, because...
So I think over the last 3 or 4 years, it's grown exponentially, without a shadow of a doubt.
Well, yeah.
I think it has. Don't get me wrong, you're not really seeing it on the ground.
No, well, maybe it's just that more people have realised they have more in common. You know what I mean? And again, people are starting to talk together now. You know what I mean? People are realising how this stuff affects them and their lives, and they see, they meet other people, and you know, they feel that they're not alone.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not just one thing, but it's part of it. So I think, yeah, people are talking and people are getting in tune, and even the water protests,
that woke an awful lot of people, a load of other different subjects.
Well, I think that made people start looking at the system that we're being put there, we're living
that's in place, yeah.
You know, we can just destroy the county councils and create a water company and say it cost us billions. And they did. They had to pay off a lot of people and give them big pensions and then obviously set them up and, you know what I mean, create a new billing company and then rehire them the next day as heads of Irish Water. You know what I mean? And then people started realising this cronyism is bigger than we think it is. That was just blatantly in your face.
And that's corruption.
It was kind of we're doing this and we're going to charge you for doing it. You know what I mean? Jobs for the boys. And people just did not stand for it. Now, that was part of it. So, you know, it's a long process, as you would say. It's what, 2016, 9/11.
That's 15 years ago, and we're still,
you know,
we're still listening to mainstream media lies, and people are still swallowing it, this stuff, the Russians did.
Normal. And the amount of evidence that's online, if one building was rigged, they were all rigged.
Yeah.
Forget everything else. You know, if one was rigged, they were all rigged. Yeah. That's it.
I mean, this even goes all the way back to the JFK assassination. Even questions raised about that.
Yeah, well,
if these questions are raised, the whole thing is in question. Then, you know.
Sure, look, it took how long JFK is, and it's still Oswald did it. He didn't. You know, and there's just been no manhunt, or there's been nobody brought to justice, or there's been nobody gone looking for these people behind it. So that goes to show you.
Now, I'm going to find a clip here now. I just want to play it. I think this is it. Now, this is a guy called Sugarman. He was on TV3 the other night. I just want to talk about fake news, right? Or the news being manipulated, even in this country. Last week, this guy put out a video about the banks, about the bailout in this country. Hold on, I'll just get the right video up. I want to make sure I have the right one. Yeah, this is it now.
It's just the Italian guy, is it?
Jonathan Sugarman, his name is, right? He was at the EU Parliament on the 15th of November gone.
Okay.
Right? Talking about what happened here in this country on the night of the bailout and in the lead up to it, right? And post the bailout as well. Right, the corruption that went on with the banks and the politicians. He names them all here. Now, this guy was on TV3. Now, I seen this video last week. I'm going to play a couple of minutes of it. I'm not going to play it all. If you want to go and look at it, folks, just type in whistleblowers Jonathan Sugarman at the EU Parliament, and you'll find this. It's a 15-minute or 13.5-minute speech, so I'm not going to play it all. But I will play a minute or two of it. But he was basically talking about the corruption within the banking system in this country and what's actually going on and the kind of wheeling and dealing that was going on behind the scenes, selling this bank off to this bank. And it reminded me, do you know what it reminded me of? EastEnders.
It's just moving numbers.
Yeah, but do you ever watch... No, I know you don't watch EastEnders, but I'm sure you've seen episodes of it over the years. One of the concepts in EastEnders is that everyone who lives in Albert Square, they all have a piece of the pie. Not one person owns the cafe. Phil might own 10% and someone else will own 20%. They all own bits of each other's businesses.
Right,
and it's a bit like that with these banks. They all sort of own a bit of each other, do you know what I mean? But nobody knows who owns what.
Well, how else would you feed the narrative to people, you know what I mean?
But it's bullshit. That's what they're feeding to people.
Yeah.
But this guy was on TV3 the other night on Vincent Brown.
Okay.
Right? Now, there should have been a revolution the next day in the streets of Ireland. But there wasn't. What dominated the news last week after he was on was... Why won't Gerry Adams name that gym or that way around, man, in the van?
Well, yeah, that's...
And it's dominated the news.
That's what they do.
This should be dominated.
That should
the news.
Be dominated. So, that's not important.
No, it's not, no.
That enslaved...
No, I'm not saying...
That transferred the wealth of the people back to the banks.
Yeah.
Basically is what happened there. You know what I mean? When you strip it down to as simple as possible, they took the money out of our budgets, handed it back to the banks, and now we have to borrow money from the banks. You know what I mean?
It's madness.
We refinanced the banks to lend us back more money. So
If you hear what this guy has to concept, it's like, God. I'm going to play this guy now. Have a listen to this guy, folks. The text number is 087-062-7138 if you want to send in any comments. 087-062-7138. Have a listen to this, folks. I'm just going to play a couple of minutes of it. This is Jonathan Sugarman at the EU Parliament on the 15th of November talking about what went on in this country with the banks prior to the bailout. Have a listen to this. Now, this guy was on TV3 last week, folks. I mean, it should have been all over the newspapers the next day, but it wasn't. The media was swamped with the Jerry Adams story last week, so nobody really got to hear about this guy unless you were watching him on TV3. But have a listen to this, and I'll be back to you in a couple of minutes.
I say the banksters, they come in all shapes, colours and nationalities. Firstly, I would like to thank GUENGL for inviting me here today. I would also like to thank them for producing this booklet, which not only tells my story, it also refers to the legislation I resigned over and puts my story in the context of other European banks operating out of Dublin. I was the risk manager for Unicredito Italiano Dublin's operation in 2007. UniCredit is the biggest bank in Italy. It owns Bank Austria Credit Anstalt. It also owns Bayerische Hypo- und Vereinsbank HVB. We are talking about a very large bank. My crime, my only crime, was to comply with Irish law. I walked broad daylight, walked down to the regulator's office, the Central Bank of Ireland, and said, I am breaking the law. I am signing for billions that do not exist. In Ireland, there's an expression that says, no good deed goes unpunished. I was punished severely. I have not been able to work for 9 years. I would also like this to take this occasion to thank the people in real life, people on Twitter, people in America, people in Australia, who've helped me to keep going, who've on more than one occasion put a roof above my head and provided me with food. Because there is a law, there is a lot of discussion, but there is nothing being done, absolutely nothing. In practical terms, I resigned 9 years ago. During the 9 years that I resigned, statements were made, for example, by the CEO of Deutsche Bank, Josef Ackermann, who said, the liquidity problems of Dublin-based DEPFA Bank last September brought the entire German banking system to within a hair's breadth of collapse. That is on page 9 in the booklet. Has Mr. Ackermann been summoned to the EU Parliament to be asked how come a bank in Dublin almost collapsed the entire German system, banking system? Has he been asked that in any forum that we know of? Which bank is he even referring to? Does anybody here know? It's a very old German bank. Exists for 250 years. Deutsche Pfandbriefbank. Did anybody know that this was the biggest bank in Ireland in the last 10 years? Why do people not know this? Why are people so intimidated? I'll tell you why. Because they get threatened, like I did, in writing by UniCredit's lawyers, verbally on more than one occasion, and threatened by utter silence. All three biggest political parties in Ireland know of my story. I met with among others, Richard Bruton, who is a minister in the current government. He responded, we met at my solicitor's office in Dublin. He responded by saying that he would be in touch with the regulator. Nothing was heard from him ever again. Michael Noonan, the current Minister of Finance in Ireland, later stated that Fine Gael had never heard of me, although there are minutes of a meeting between me and Richard Bruton at a solicitor's firm. John Burton, who later became Deputy Prime Minister of Ireland, met me in person, raised my issue in the Irish Parliament, but never said a word once she came to power. So the silence is what is working against us. The lack of cooperation is also working against us. Mr. Molindo earlier referred to LGT Bank. How many people here today know what happened of LGT Bank in Germany? How many people among the Dutch people know that after you bailed out a failed bank called ABN AMRO, it went on to buy LGT Bank, belonging to the Duke of Liechtenstein, in Bavaria? So a bailed out Dutch bank goes and buys a private bank in Bavaria? How many people in Holland know about this? Why? Do you not have a media? Do you not have a parliament?
Like they said last week, even the national media is quite often rigged and they don't want to show you the
other. Well, it tells quite a lot that I was interviewed, my first television interview was by Australian television, Australian ABC, Australian state television, came all the way to Dublin to interview me. The Central Bank of Ireland refused, and I saw the refusal with my own eyes, in writing. The Central Bank of Ireland refused to go on record. It might have something to do with the fact that the chairman of my bank in Ireland, after this happened, after I reported a breach of billions, was appointed as a director to the Central Bank of Ireland. His letter of appointment to the Central Bank of Ireland appears in this booklet. You are welcome to see it with your own eyes, how a chairman of a bank, page 47, was then appointed to the regulating body. So how much truth are we going to have? The citizens of Ireland have been going through unbelievable austerity in the last decade for bailing out a bank called...
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to play the whole lot because I said it's about 30 minutes long. I played 6 minutes there, nearly seven. Jonathan Sugarman is the guy's name. So go on to YouTube, folks. He's there. You can hear the rest of this.
There you have it, like.
No, I'll tell you, I'll put it up onto the Words You Don't Know page later on. I might already be up there, actually. I might have shared it last week. As I said just before I played that clip, he was on the Vincent Brown Show the other night, talking about what he's talking about now.
But like, that's
and it. Yet there was no outcry the next day in the media. It was all...
But like,
you know, he was on the night before. Gerry Adams had that meeting crashed on Wednesday or Thursday morning. That chap, the prison officer's son. Now, I'm not saying the chap doesn't have a grievance. Of course he does. His father was murdered by the IRA and he wants answers, and that's fair enough.
Of course.
But the timing of it...
But that's what it is.
To completely cloud what this guy was talking about.
To cloud
about.
Out that. That's what they don't want. But like the fact that the CEO of the bank was then like put into the regulator's position, well, that just goes to show that like he's to make sure that this goes on.
Goes nowhere, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like this is to keep the system going.
Now, but it's no wonder the country's in such a jock. But like, when you see the likes of this going on, I mean, look at the homeless crisis we have in this country. It's madness. That, you know, families are living out of hotel rooms, like, for God's sake.
Yeah.
A quarter of a million bloody houses boarded up around the country, unoccupied.
Yeah.
You know, no one living in them. The bank's holding most of these properties.
To raise the price
of property up and the price of rent up. And yet this corruption is allowed to go on. But aren't people not rioting on the streets, but there should be a peaceful revolution. That's what is needed.
But what that guy said there was like he came in and he said he's facilitating, he's signing away the transfer of billions that don't exist, right? And yeah, you have to think about it. The money that we give to the banks, the so-called money, that didn't exist. It just came off our balance sheet in numbers and went over to theirs. Mm. There was no money. There was never physical money.
There was no
money.
Tangible assets.
There was no tangible assets, exactly. It was just transferring the wealth. So that's basically, we're taking away your ability now to provide your services, because we had record tax intakes, didn't we, while that was going on, like, and we were like exceeding the
crave all expectations.
But it was all like
it's like Bertie Ahern said, the money is a wash, or the country was a wash with money.
But yeah, but you see, it's not money. They're just it was digital money going from a European bank into your bank account, which didn't, you never got to see it. Then that got transferred to someone's other's bank account, so it never existed. It was just a transfer of digital money, and it's that's It's crazy when you think about it. We're all slaves to a digital, like to something that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
That piece of money in your hand, that's just there to keep you focused on that this is working is worthwhile. You know what I mean? It's to keep your mind thinking that
there
this
seems to be an agenda, though. No, I mean, you're talking about money in the hand. There seems to be an agenda.
On digital money, yeah.
There seems to be an agenda now at the moment to do away with cash altogether. And I'm going to get into that after the break, folks. I need to go to a set of ads. I'll only be about 10 minutes, so hang loose there, folks. I'm starting to be back to talk about the future of money, I suppose, is a good way of looking at it. So talk to you in a couple of minutes.
You're listening to Liffey Sound. www.liffeysoundfm.ie. Listen online. Community radio at its best.
Now, folks, you're very welcome back. Now, just before the break, we were talking about the future of money, and we ended up getting onto money, so we're going to talk about the future of money for the next couple of minutes. And there's lots of ads on the telly, and I'm sure you've been watching it yourself lately, about this new, download this AIB app, and you can pay now by just swiping your phone at the till, you know, there's no need for cash anymore.
Really?
Yeah, these are ads around. This is like for Dublin, like you can do this here now in Ireland. You can download an app now to swipe off. Yeah, you'd have a Visa card, like, you know, the swipe card.
Oh, I get it. I get it, yeah.
So you download the accompanying app.
Yeah.
That's on your phone.
Yeah.
And all you got to do is just do that.
Swipe your phone
across the machine, and that will pay for your goods. Yeah. Now, some people are going to say, oh, that's brilliant.
That's convenient.
That's great. That's like, the invention of the microwave oven, you know, fast food.
Mm.
Now we've got fast money, you know. You don't have to fiddle around for change in your purse now. You just, and it's all done.
Faster lives.
Wonderful. Too. How great is that going to be? But here's the danger of it. If there is no cash and you decide you don't want to play ball with what the government does, you don't like water charges, you don't like this, you don't like that, and you decide to protest, all they have to do to get at you is to switch your card off.
That's it.
Switch your phone off. Don't let you transact. How are you supposed to survive? And people don't realise that this is the agenda. Now, I remember I played clips of a video on it. I'd urge people to watch it. Aaron Russo. Do you remember Aaron Russo? The director of Trading Places,
the movie. Yeah.
He made a video with Alex Jones where he was basically saying that he had meetings with one of the Rockefellers. I think it was, I can't remember his name. It was one of the Rockefellers from New York anyway, not David Rockefeller, one of his brothers. And he had a few lunch meetings with him. But at these meetings, and this is all prior to 9/11, at these meetings he had divulged his family and other rich family, elite families, plans for the world going forward in the next 20 years. And he said that basically, he said the banks run the world. And the plan that they had was to get a one world government in place, because they're fed up with all these petty disputes worldwide over resources and minerals and whatnot. And they just want one world government. We own it all now and we'll do what we want.
Mm.
A reduction in the population in accordance with the guidelines on the Georgia Guidestones, i.e. wipe out 6 billion people and bring the population down to 500 million. In perpetual balance with nature, so as the world doesn't have to suffer anymore under the strain of humanity. This is what their philosophy is. Now, he said all this is supposed to be going ahead, but he also told them at one of these meetings that there was going to be an event. He didn't say what the event was, but he said there was going to be an event. And out of that event, we would go to war with Afghanistan, Iraq, and several other nations around the world.
Mm.
And there would be a war on terror, and we'd be looking for terrorists in caves. And he said, but it would all be just fake. It would all be a hoax. It would all be perpetrated by the media. None of it would be real.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, now it's really happening.
And now that's really happening. Now, Aaron Russo is dead now, so we can't get him on the show to find out, was he predicting the future or was he genuinely told this stuff? But if he was genuinely told this stuff, one of the big plans he said that they had was to do away with cash and only have digital money. Now, he made this documentary 13, 14 years ago, just after 9/11 happened. Mm. This is why he made the thing with Alex Jones, because he was startled by what he'd seen. Now, they wanted Aaron Russo, they'd said to him, listen, you go along with our plans, you know, make documentaries for us, because he was a documentary maker, that further our agenda, you know, and push our agenda out into the world and stuff like that. And like, we'll make you very, very wealthy. We look after your family alone. He says, well, no, I'm not going along with this. I've got a conscience. Now, he's since passed away from cancer. But if he is telling the truth, well, this cashless society thing is taking off now. You can see it happening. It's going on here. They're making cash look bad now by having these swipe things on your phone. And yes, they're selling it as convenience.
Of course, yeah.
But it's not convenient if you can't operate without cash and you decide to protest against what the government is doing. And as I said, all you have to do is turn off your card. But he went one step further and said that the ultimate agenda of the banks, if all this is true, the New World Order, is to get all your information and all your financial money, everything, all on a little chip that's embedded in your hand. You know, a chip inside the body. And as he was saying, if you don't play ball, all you got to do is turn that chip off.
Yeah, no, like they just want to do away the convenience of actually going to have to print money, you know. Because like at the moment, it's no difference now. You go like you have to go to work all the time for cash, okay? Which is just basically the same thing. It's to keep you going, keep you on the treadmill, keep you going back to the George Carlin says, keep you going back to that job. You know, like, you just have to, because that's basically what turns the whole wheel is all of us going to work. You know what I mean? To and from every day. You can't provide for yourself. You can't put a roof over your head. You have to keep going to work, Like, don't get me wrong. You have to work. You can't be doing nothing. But like, we're trapped into it. Some of us, a lot of us are trapped into jobs that we don't want to be in.
Trapped in the matrix.
Well, yeah, I know. But like, a lot of people out there, they're going to work and it's not their love. You know what I mean? It's not what they really want to do.
Well, I've seen a post there online. And it was a quote, and basically the quote says, you know, mankind is insane. Like, a working man is an insane man, he said, because you're driven insane because you have to force yourself out of bed at an ungodly hour in the morning, right? Get dressed to go to work, right? Work 8 hours a day, right? In clothes that you have to pay for, in a car that you have to pay for. So you got to work to get both of those things. You got to work to get the house. Do you know what I mean? Course, so you're working 8 hours a day for a house that you barely ever live in.
Yeah, you're not in it during the day. You're at work all the time.
And he said, it's basically the definition of insanity that we, you know, as a collective species, we continue to do this.
Yeah, well, head down, keep pedaling.
But that's what, I don't know if you've ever seen that movie from the 1920s, Metropolis.
No.
It's a black and white movie. I'd recommend it. Like, if you want to know how the world really works, watch that.
Really?
It's like, for whoever made it, I don't know who made the movie now, but it's way ahead of its time. But it's sort of like 1984 on steroids. You just see all the people going to work. It's a silent movie, like, with just music. But they're like robots doing the same monotonous, boring crap job day in, day out. And like you says, to keep the machine rolling.
Yeah, of course.
You know?
Like, well, it keeps the banks and money, doesn't it?
You know, and at the top of the factory, like, you have the executive, like, who owns it all, and he's dead, and the money's rolling in and rolling in and rolling in. And I think it's a very good piece of filmmaking. It's very, very well made. And as I said, it was made in the 1920s. It's called Metropolis, and it's been parodied plenty of times. Like, even Madonna has parodied it in some of her music videos. Like, she would recreate scenes from Metropolis in them, you know? But it was like a sci-fi movie in the 1920s, but it was very, very foretelling of how the world actually is, that... You know, even in office jobs, like, people are in there doing the same monotonous thing over and over and over. It's the same thing day in, day out.
Yeah.
You might think it's different because you wear different clothes and you have a different lunch and you take a different route to work, but it's not. It's the same thing over and over and over. Like you said, we're on, you know, you're on a treadmill.
Repetitiveness.
You know, because at the end of the day, if you work 8 hours a day, sleep 8 hours a night, that's 2/3 of your life that don't belong to you.
Well, they do.
But they don't,
like,
you know.
Like we dreams.
But you've only got, well, yeah, dreams, I suppose, yeah, dreams. But what I'm saying is, you know, if you sleep 8 hours a night, work 8 hours a day, you've only got 8 hours left then to get stuff done. You know, so...
You're going to and from work, looking after the kids.
But that's another 2 or 3 hours as well.
Yeah.
Eating out of your day. So, I mean, that's the way the world works, unfortunately, you know. Getting back to this guy, Sugarman, just before we do move on from him, why do you think that, like, collectively the people in this country, like... Most people will probably watch TV3 and Vincent Brown. Why there hasn't been an outcry about this guy? Like, people should be up in arms about this, if that level of corruption was going on at that time.
Well, look, we do know what was going on, but who did they outcry to?
Well, I mean, stand outside.
You never know. The next day, there could have been a few people out there, but who paid any attention to them? The media didn't. So, like, it's their job to report on this, and they didn't at the time. And they're certainly not now. So it's all a big Ponzi scheme that we have to keep going on it.
Yeah.
Like, and that's like, we transferred from Irish money to euros. So, like, where did it come from? You know, they just printed it off and said, there you go, right? We'll set your wage at this, we'll set the prices at this. And, like, as you know yourself, when this place was awash with money, the prices went up.
Yeah.
You know, to keep your... So you
well, I noticed that now with the euro, the big rip-off with the euro. And it was something I actually had my eye on at the time, because I remember prior to the euro coming out, you had dual pricing.
Yeah.
You go into the shops and you'd see the price in old Irish pounds and in the new euro. So if a bag of sugar was a pound, it was €1.27.
Yeah.
But what happened was, when the pound disappeared, a bag of sugar was no longer 1.27, it was 1.55.
Yeah, well, that's it.
You know what I mean? Like, they were dealing with everything.
It was just to facilitate the changeover. Like,
But I think the term was coined straight away after that rip-off Ireland, because everybody was looking at stuff in the shops and you could see the rip-off of what it was.
But here, take for example, me and you got 2 packets of crisps and 2 bars of chocolate tonight.
You paid for them?
Yeah, €5.05.
Are you serious? See, I remember when I was a kid, you got the pictures for that.
Yeah, we're about, I remember like a pound, you'd have 2 bars of chocolate and 2 packets of crisps for a pound.
Are you serious?
Yeah, of course.
Well, that wasn't even that long ago.
It wasn't that long ago.
And you paid that for
them? €5.05.
Two bars of chocolate.
I just looked at it. You don't even argue anymore.
Or I remember a chomp is 10 pence.
Yeah.
Do you know a chomp is 90 cent now? I think it's about 90 cent.
It is not.
I think it is, yeah.
Jeez.
You know, I mean, a pack of crisps is €1. A can of Coke is like 1.50 or something.
Yeah.
Like even lollipops are 30 pence now. A 20 cent for a lolly. They used to be 5 pence. You know, it's just, it's mad. We do live in rip-off Ireland, unfortunately. So that's the way it is. There's nothing we can really do, is there, you know?
Actually, I think it was €2.40 for 2 packets. Oh, no, 2 bars of chocolate last week. I don't buy chocolate that often, you know what I mean? So when I went into the garage, obviously paying for the petrol, got 2 bars. I was like, what?
Well, I've noticed that about most of those convenience shops that you see in garages, the prices are off the scale. Like, even for, like, 2 litres of milk, like €2.75, you know, in a garage. Unless you buy the real cheap brand, that's... not that nice.
not that creamy.
Yeah. You know, but I mean, €2.75 for milk is just ridiculous, you know.
I don't know.
I think it is. I mean, you know, you can go into some place and get it for €1, but anyway, you know, there's no...
drink less milk anyway, that's what I'd say.
Yeah, well, yeah, it's cow juice, isn't it? It's baby cow growth juice, that's what it is.
Yeah, cow fattening juice.
We're not supposed to drink milk. We're really
not on the level that we do.
You know, and particularly the process that milk goes through, like for... what's that process?
Pasteurisation
to make it last longer. You know, that's changes the genetic structure of the milk. So, you know, they say some vegans reckon we shouldn't be touching milk at all.
Yeah, well, it makes sense. Like, it's the milk of another animal, you know.
Well, that's it. You know, we don't feed other animals human milk, you know.
Well, humans don't continue to feed all their lives, do they?
Oh, no, I suppose.
from their mothers, like.
Funny you should say that. I was listening to the radio the other day and there was... what was the man's Niall Boylan show, but he was talking about women who breastfeed.
Hmm.
Well, not just breastfeed babies. I mean, I think breastfeeding is a wonderful thing. We own it.
It's the best thing.
Of course it is. But it seems to be a taboo in public to breastfeed. Why, I don't know, but it is. But it's okay to kill people in public, but it's not okay to do that in public. However, he was talking about breastfeeding 7 and 8 year olds, that there's women out there who still do, you know. And his show was like, is it right? I don't know. I mean, I don't remember breastfeeding that moment. I don't think I did, but I probably did. I'm not sure. I don't remember, but I certainly wasn't doing it by the time I was 8 years of age. I'd already smoked my confirmation on my communion money at that stage, went on cigarettes. I'm only joking, but yeah, they were. But you know, that's each their own, I suppose, if people want to.
I've never heard of that now, in fairness.
Oh, yeah, Google it. It does come on, doesn't it? No, I'm telling you. I'm not joking with you. You can Google it. The show's over now in a couple of minutes, folks. So I just want to end up on a light note. There's something I want to give a mention to. Earlier on, I brought my little lad down to... Oh, what's the name of that road I was at now again? Down in Dolphins Barn. I can never remember the name of it now. It'll come to me now in a moment. Anyway, I went down to see Josie's Lights. And Josie's Lights is a house down at the back of... Dolphins Barn Fire Station there, just off Ockavanna Road in Crumlin. And it's a non-council house, it's a, you know, three-bedroom house. But the lights on it are absolutely amazing. Now, I will put a picture up on the World You Don't Know page later on for anyone that wants to see it. But you can go onto Facebook and just type in Josie's Lights on Facebook and you'll see the house. Now, fair play to them. We went down tonight to see Santa Claus and the whole place is all lit up. It's like a proper little Christmas wonderland. It's beautiful. But they're raising money for Focus Ireland, for the homeless, which is a very good cause. Now, we went down and threw a few quid into the bucket for them. So, if anyone listening does want to head down that way over the next week or two to see Josie's Lights, go down any time between, I suppose, 6 p.m. and 9 p.m. They only have them on for a few hours. And bring your kids with you. You'll get to meet Santa Claus. They're down there trying to raise money for a very, very worthy cause, Focus Ireland. They're trying to raise money for homeless people. So, go down there, donate a few, bob. Go down, get your photographs taken with Santa Claus. This has been The World You Don't Know, so until next week, folks, remember, the world is full of great people. If you can't find one, be one. Talk to you all very soon.
The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically, opposed to secret society, the secret oath, and the secret proceedings.
Waking humanity, one soul at a time. This is The World You Don't Know Radio.
Show with your host, Nick O'Connell.